So let's come back to the last question during previous lecture. So the question was either it is easier to verify what SL2R is not compact. In fact, the corresponding demonstration is relatively easy. We may build a sequence of elements in SL2R of the form of upper triangular matrices. When the such sequence of elements definitely is not a Cauchy sequence at all and does not have any Cauchy subsequence, so it cannot converge to anything. So that subsequence cannot converge to anything. So that has not got an accumulation point. In fact, that example is a particular discrete subgroup of the one-parameter continuous subgroup, which we will consider in details today. This is a subgroup of upper triangular matrices. And that is obtained as exponent of corresponding product of parameter T and generator of this subgroup. And generator of this subgroup is matrix with zero trace, upper triangular one of this form. And similarly, we may build another sequence, Yn, which consists, say, of a to the power n 0, 0, a to the power n minus 1. But again, a sequence which does not have any convergent subsequence. And again, it would be discrete subgroup of the continuous subgroup A, which we will consider today, of diagonal matrices. So we consider that subgroup today in details again. And well, general requirement for a Lie group to be compact is what such continuous one-parameter subgroup of certain value of parameter come back to unit element. So if you will think about the group of rotation of unit sphere, for example, in two-dimensional case, whatever one-parameter subgroup of rotation of unit sphere you will take, eventually after full rotation, it comes to the identity. And that is happen always for any compact subgroup. And in SL2R, we have a subgroup of type N and subgroup of type N, which does not cycle. So whenever you take a value of parameter, identity element appears only at point t equals 0 here. And whenever that happens, that demonstrates what our subgroup is non-compact. Did I explain that matter? Okay. So let us then come back to our study of SL2R. So we was stopped last time, I think, in some point. Oops, jumped too far. So we spoke about one-parameter subgroup and where generators and how subgroups, one-parameter continuous subgroup, can be obtained by mean of exponentiation, and what only algebra consisting of generators, one parameter continuous subgroup, where is operation of commutator, which we will look more closely later. When we spoke about groups and homogeneous spaces, this is where our group act transitively, which is necessary for Klein approach, Erlangen program approach to the geometry. We need transitive action of a group on corresponding space. And we discussed decomposition of or represent parametrization of any homogeneous space in term of corresponding fixed group of a point. So having such fixed group H, we are able to realize homogeneous space or collection of cosets G over H. So that was a rather general theory. When we want to look how that construction is applicable to SL to R. So to make our consideration complete, we tried to see first all two-dimensional subgroup. So they are in the effect are parameterized by the well, not parameterized, where are all continuous subgroup are conjugated to the subgroup of upper or lower triangular matrices. This is subgroup F and F dash on that slide. So of course these two subgroups is already conjugated one to another. It's easy to verify what if we have a matrix A0, C1, then we may simply put the conjugation, I think, with a matrix of this type to obtain the upper triangular form. So inverse will be 0 minus 1, 1, 0. So that is a conjugation of lower and upper triangular matrices. That is rather important two-dimensional subgroup, but for some reasons we will not stop too much on this subgroup in our course. We will more closely look on the one-parameter continuous subgroup. And examples of such subgroup are given in formulas 1 to 3. This is A and K, so a diagonal upper triangular with units on diagonal subgroup N, and a subgroup K consisting of cosine, sine, minus sine, and cosine T. Again, this is exponential of zero trace matrix. So this is examples, and that collection of examples is exhausting in the sense what any other continuous one-parameter continuous subgroup of cell to R is conjugate either to subgroup A, N, or K from the previous slide. So, to have demonstration why we indeed have such a statement, I recall what one-parameter subgroup are parameterized, are connected with their generator by exponentiation of corresponding element. In terms of matrix subgroup, for example, cell to R, we may treat that series very straightforwardly. We calculate simply powers of matrices, then make Taylor expansion of the exponent, add this all together, and obtain the result. So for us, the key point, what will be the powers of the generator? And very simple calculation, if we will do it by hand, so we will see what taking a matrix with zero trace, so that matrix shall be of form A, B, C, and make it zero trace, last element shall be minus A, then multiply it to itself, when usual rules give us A square plus BC, and then here we have zero, here we have another zero, and in this point we have BC plus A squared. So that actually is the identity matrix times A square plus BC. This is square of our matrix, and because of that, it's easy to calculate what for any traceless matrix x to the power n will be for n even certain corresponding, so if it's 2n, it will be a square plus bc to the power n times the identity matrix, and with odd power, we simply have a square plus bc to the power n times x. When in Taylor series, we have a very nice split, so e2 to the power x will be the simple sum of identity matrix times the series where we are summing up from 1 to infinity of a square plus bc to the power n over 2 n factorial plus x times n from 1 to infinity of a square plus bc n 2n plus 1 2n plus 1 factorial. So as you can see, matrix elements appear here in front of sums. So essentially we need to sum up corresponding series, and behavior of this series is very well known. So it depends from the sign of entry which we have here. So it behaves either as so summation probably shall be done from zero, I think, in this case. So it behaves either as sine cosine function, usual trigonometric function, or as hyperbolic function. So result of calculation. So our key lemma for that characterization is what the square of x is the identity matrix times minus determinant of x when decomposition of exponent of generators times t. I forget about t here. So it shall be t to the power 2n. Here it shall be t to the power 2n plus 1. Making that expansion, behavior of series crucially depend on the sign of determinant of x which appears in that decomposition. So if determinant of x minus determinant of x is negative, then its Taylor series behave as sine and cosine, and we obtain something which is similar to subgroup K. If determinant is equal to zero, then all terms here will disappear. We have just all terms for n bigger than 1 will be equal to 0 in that case. So we are left just with one term out of entire series, and that will create upper triangular subgroup n. And if our minus determinant is positive, then in this case we have expansion of hyperbolic sine and cosine function, and that lead to the subgroup which is similar to subgroup A. So no other possibilities exist in this simple case, and that help us to proceed with full description of geometries which are associated to SL2R. So here is the again reminder of the scheme which we have for the for a general group and corresponding homogeneous spaces. So when we consider the collection of cosets G over H, we introduce the equivalence relation, that cosets introduced by equivalence relation, which tell us what two elements are in the same coset whenever there is H from the subgroup which satisfy two highlighted identity. When there is a natural projection P which send every element of the group to the corresponding coset, to the coset which contain that element of subgroup. That projection is natural. We it's defined without our choice. But there is a choice if we will try to build the opposite map. It cannot be inverse because it's P is projection, it's send many to one. So opposite map cannot be inverse, but it's right inverse of P. So we for every coset we pick up the element from the group which is which belong to that particular coset, and we are making it in a way such would the map S is continuous in respective topology. Our group is topological. There is certain notion of neighborhoods on this group, and when we consider equivalence classes, we again can have quotient topology on collection of cosets. So we define S to be a continuous section, as it's called. And in general, existence of a section for some groups may be non-trivial question, but because we are working with very particular example, we will present S in explicit form, so continuity and existence of this S is straightforward. It's just a direct check. So, of course, choice of such S is not unique. There is certain freedom, but essentially it's possible to demonstrate what if instead of one particular continuous section, you will choose another particular continuous section, then the theory construction which will follow will not be much different. So essentially, there are certain isomorphism, there are certain operators which can be written explicitly and map one results to another. So dependence from S, it's rather on the level on certain particular formulas, rather on some general results. So that choice is not essential. Now, armed with that map S and P, we may define action of our group G on corresponding homogeneous space. And that is presented by such square diagram. So procedure is as follows. We pick up an element from homogeneous space, that is a particular coset, and use a map S to raise it to the group. So for every coset, we pick up a certain representative elements from that coset. Then on every such representative, we act by multiplication with element of group G from the left. Due to our equivalence relation, because equivalence relation is defined by multiplication from the right, even for non-commutative groups as SL to R, the multiplication from the left commute with multiplication from the right. That means what multiplication by G from the left does not break equivalence relation. So after shifting from the left by G, we still respect our coset relation, and then we may apply the map P, which map element of the new element from the group to corresponding coset. So if we will combine that three maps together, S multiplication from the by G from the left and projection P, three map together, will produce a certain map of homogeneous space to itself, which we will denote by G with dot. So multiplication on the group will be denoted by star, and dot will identify action of a group on elements of homogeneous spaces. So that is a rather general construction. Again, let's see how it's work for our particular situation, where we take group G to be SL to R, and subgroup B subgroup F of lower triangular matrices. So this is subgroup F, which we defined with lower triangular matrices. Homogeneous space in this case, because subgroup SL to R is three-dimensional, subgroup F is two-dimensional, homogeneous space is one-dimensional. So essentially, classes, equivalent cassettes, can be parameterized by one real number. So, and projection P may be treated as a map from SL to R to real numbers, and it assign a value B over D to element ABCD in SL to R. Then right inverse for this map will put the real number U, so map S will put real number U to the upper triangular matrices 1, U, 0, 1. And then action, which defined by weight square diagram, which is a composition of these three maps, S, multiplication by G, and projection. So if we will simply make a substitution in that formula of above map, S, U, and P defined above, we will obtain that known formula for Moebius transformation, linear fractional transformation for the real numbers. So we will obtain a map of linear fractional one here. So that is our first observation. And as we see, as an application of that general construction, in that particular case, we will obtain something interesting. Really, Moebius transformation of real line is already non-trivial object. So it's not just affine transformation of the ix plus b form, which preserve things or geometric affine geometry of the real line. It's also include inversion, so division by 1 over x, and all that map is quite interesting already. Let's move forward and apply the same general procedure, so the same procedure with the action on homogeneous spaces for the one-parameter subgroup. Well, at this point, we will mention a result which somehow easier to confuse with our previous proposition, which characterize all one-parameter subgroup. So previously, we was describe any one-parameter continuous subgroup as to be conjugate to one of subgroup A and K. There is so-called Iwasawa decomposition, so that is first displayed formula on this slide, which represent any matrix ABCD as a product of three matrices, one from each respective subgroup, diagonal subgroup A, upper triangular subgroup N, and that's a compact subgroup K. There is some deep theory behind Iwasawa decomposition, so subgroup K is maximal. That type of decomposition is true for a generic semi-simple Lie group. K shall be a maximal compact subgroup, N is nilpotent subgroup, A normalize N, other way around. A is commutative and abelian, so this is why it's A, and N normalize A. So that kind of decomposition is rather general and rather important in the structural theory of general semi-simple Lie group. But in our construction, it will not play big role. We will not use it much, that Iwasawa decomposition. And somehow, again, I wish to draw a line. What Iwasawa decomposition is not equivalent to proposition which characterize all one-dimensional continuous subgroup. In particular, besides Iwasawa decomposition, in the theory of semi-simple Lie group, there is so-called Cartan decomposition, where you have a decomposition not on the form ANK, but rather KAK, again, without N. And it also has its own merits for certain situation. So, but Cartan decomposition omit subgroup N. It does not use it at all. And we will not omit subgroup N. Rather, we will put particular attention to subgroup N in our construction. So, again, the same square diagram. And now we use the following observation. Subgroup group SL to R is three-dimensional. We factorize with respect to one-dimensional continuous subgroup. So resulting homogeneous space is two-dimensional. And we will initially parameterize point of corresponding cosets to buy the upper triangular matrices or by a pair of points, and we so we take parameters U and V on the plane to parameterize cosets, and write inverse embedding of S, embedding of a point on the plane into matrices, will send it to the upper triangular matrix of this type. And you may see here, of course, if we ask determinant of this matrix to be positive, then V shall be non-negative or positive number. It shall be a positive number. So that is essentially shows what we do parameterization by points not of entire plane, but upper half plane. Rather, we use upper half plane to parameterize our cosets. Now, again, the same action on the homogeneous space can be evaluated for any subgroup H from the type A, N, and K. So that is maybe a calculation which not so pleasant as it was for two-dimensional subgroup. Expression became more complicated, but result is as follow. If we have a point UV on the upper half plane, then the image under Moebius transformation will become a point with this fraction, which you remotely may associate with linear fractional transformation. And what is the role of different subgroups? So map S here was independent from the type of subgroup A and K, which we are considering. But resulting expression, depending from this type of subgroup, will have a parameter sigma. So sigma appears in this expression on several places. And that parameter sigma is taking value minus 1, so for subgroup K. It takes value 0 for subgroup N, and it takes value 1 for subgroup A. And you may already know what homogeneous space of SL to R over compact subgroup K can be associated with the Lobachevsky plane, upper half plane. So that is, and moreover, SL to R, if factorized with respect to compact subgroup, produce isometries of the Lobachevsky upper half plane. So that suggests what that formula, which we have here, shall be written somehow using complex numbers. Or, as we will see, complex numbers are not alone working in all three cases. Rather, we will need to consider hypercomplex numbers. So we now introduce such annotation, U plus IV, where I is now a hypercomplex unit, which squared to that parameter sigma, which we discussed before. So I squared to minus 1 for subgroup K, to 0 for subgroup N, and 1 for subgroup A. Well, when it's squared to minus 1, somehow it's clear what I cannot be a real number. No real number squared to negative 1. But when it's squared to 0 and 1, we need separately said what that imaginary hypercomplex unit I is not real number 0 or 1. It's not a real number. It's something which squared to 0 and 1, but not being real number itself. And if we will introduce such hypercomplex numbers with this hypercomplex unit, then all three formulas considered before with different value of parameter sigma can be now written in uniform way. So we will obtain a linear fractional transformation of this hypercomplex number. So parameter sigma now is disappearing explicitly. It's implicitly is inside of that hypercomplex unit. And that formula, of course, is much simpler. It's easier to look on this formula than on the previous one. in this situation, of course, we need to discuss what meaning for this fraction shall be assigned if we are doing a division by a zero, or even worse, as we will again discuss soon, the numbers which we'll have here, they have so-called divisors of zeros. So unlike the complex numbers, that hypercomplex numbers does not form a field. It's rather commutative, associative, two-dimensional algebra with divisors of zeros. So let's look briefly. Well, complex numbers are very well known, and everyone acknowledges that complex numbers are very important, both mathematically and in application, from point of view pure theory and applications, which, according to some philosophies, of course, the same. But that other numbers, hypercomplex number, are not so well known, and so you may have a happy life of mathematical researcher and never heard about them during entire your career. So let's discuss briefly what the role or philosophical meaning of these numbers. Well, appearance, we will treat that situation in terms of standard decomposition of or classification of mathematical object in terms of elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic. And that classification is rather natural when you have just one-dimensional parameter on certain object and certain special point of reference. That point of reference split one-dimensional parameter into a line, if you want, into two disjoint parts. And so you have something to the left, which you called hyperbolic, something to the right, elliptic, and that reference point is parabolic one. And we use that classification in terms of our hypercomplex unit. So traditionally, complex unit in mathematics denoted by I, so its square is minus one. Numbers are called complex number, and we will treat it as elliptic case. When there is a reference case, parabolic one, which correspond to so-called dual numbers. So imaginary unit, hypercomplex unit here will be denoted by epsilon. So we say epsilon square is equal to zero, and that is somehow refer to typical usage of epsilon in mathematical analysis as something small. If you have a small epsilon, then square of epsilon even smaller. It's negligibly small on the scale of epsilon itself. So it's in terms of analysis, but we will treat it even stricter. We say what it's not epsilon square, something negligibly small compared to epsilon. It's exactly zero. So that explain why we use such a letter. And finally, there are numbers, hypercomplex case, hyperbolic case, where hypercomplex unit squared to one. So that is numbers has a different name. Sometimes it's called split complex numbers because from the pure algebraic point of view, these numbers are rather trivial. So this is just two copies, direct sum of real numbers. So if you make a direct sum of two real numbers, you obtain structurally the collection of split complex or double numbers. But geometrically, situation is not so trivial for hyperbolic case, for double numbers, and we will demonstrate it in our course. And besides geometry, that decomposition into three situation, elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic, can be traced down to representation in vector spaces. So we obtain three different type of representation cell to R group connected with discrete complementary and principal series representation of cell to R. And if we will use it for spectral theory of operator that will be again associated with discrete, residual, and continuous spectrum of an operator, and so on. So there are quite clear parallel line or usage of that hypercomplex number in our theory. It's justify the introduction into our course, but that, of course, well, if you, at this point you may ask, if they are so useful, why other people not speaking about them much? And reason is as follow: there are certain difficulties if you are dealing with dual and double numbers. First of all, there are divisors of zeros. When it's clear what epsilon itself is divisor of zero, it's not a zero, but square is equal to zero, and any multiple of epsilon is divisor of zero. So divisors of zeros on the dual numbers form that vertical line. So that vertical axis, so A times epsilon, this is divisors of zeros in dual numbers. With double numbers, divisors of zeros form even larger set. If you will consider the identity, what 1 plus j times 1 minus j will be 1 minus j squared, which is 0. That shows what divisors of zeros are forming that set, geometrical set on the double numbers. And that, in fact, is object which easy to associate with the light cone. So geometry of double numbers is closely connected with Lorentz transformation and very simple two-dimensional, one space-dimensional, y-time-dimensional Minkowski space-time object. And divisors of zeros here in the geometry is exactly light cone. This is points which connected with the origin reference point by propagation with speed of light. And so that make construction or consideration of these double numbers very meaningful in terms of physical application. But of course, extensive set of divisors of zero for dual and double numbers, of course, create certain problems which need to be carefully treated, properly considered, if we want to deal with them seriously. And another advantage of complex numbers, besides what it is a field, so all operations, including divisions, are permitted. So dual and double number are not algebraically closed. So if you have the polynomial equation with coefficient in corresponding commutative algebra, dual and double numbers, the root of this polynomial may not lie inside that algebra. So that is another obstacle that make their consideration not so straightforward. But again, that can be properly addressed in appropriate places. So this is probably two serious problems which restrict popularity of these numbers, but nevertheless they appear one way or another when people make some substitutes. For example, you may think about the epsilon to be realized as this matrix, which is not zero matrix itself, but clearly square of this matrix is zero matrix. So a lot of things which use that relations in matrix 2 times 2 matrix terms may be equally well represented with the usage of double numbers, dual numbers, sorry. So that was somehow justification why investigate this number at all. But I wish again to stress one point which may be hidden a bit in the previous presentation. When we arrive to these numbers, when we obtain them in linear fractional transformation with these numbers, we don't make it by our hand. It's not our wish to consider them. They simply appear if we treat subgroup A, N, and K on the equal basis. Typically, in mathematics, subgroup K of SL to R obtain much greater attention, much greater consideration than two other subgroup A and N. And if we just put equality policy, apply equality policy here to all subgroups, we will have to consider corresponding hypercomplex number as well. So now let's look on corresponding Moebius transformation. So we have Moebius transformation. They may be quite not trivial, and probably it's better to start from simpler reduced cases. And again, we will use that Iwasawa decomposition where arbitrary element ABCD is represented as a product of element from A, N, and K. And we try to see what Moebius transformation correspond to matrices of each type. And it turns out, what if you do Moebius transformation as in displayed form, either for complex, dual, or double numbers with diagonal matrix tau, tau inverse, when result really does not depend from the type of numbers you are using. And this is very easy to see because Moebius transformation in that case will be simply for hypercomplex number O plus I V, that matrix tau 0, 0, tau inverse, send double O to a number which is tau squared double O. So this is just dilation, so scaling. And orbits on this picture shown to be straight line starting from the origin. And we put here also corresponding vector field, which act as infinitesimal generator of a transformation. So it's small gray arrows on the diagram. And we put some transversal lines. They are transformed one into another by the action of the corresponding one parameter subgroup. Similarly, if I will apply the upper triangular matrices 1, T, 0, 1 to double O, then linear fractional Moebius transformation will reduce simply to the translation by a real parameter T. So orbit will be horizontal line, so we are moving along the U axis, and transversal line, which obtained, let's say, from imaginary axis, will be just a collection of vertical lines. And again, there are some arrows here, gray arrows, which represent infinitesimal generators of this shift. As you see, action of subgroup A and N is rather simple, so, and is not dependent from the type of imaginary unit which we are using. So that expression is independent from the type of imaginary unit which is inside of it. The situation is different if we will consider subgroup K. So you will consider matrices cosine, sine, minus sine, cosine. Well, for complex numbers, that transformation is very well known. It can be seen in some complex analysis textbook. This is, as I told before, isometries of the Lobachevsky upper half plane. So in this is really rotation. So we have a kind of rotation around imaginary unit I, And here shown orbits, which for complex numbers turn to be circles. And also there are some transversal line which obtained from vertical axis when we rotate around imaginary unit, vertical axis come to these other circles which are orthogonal to the real line. So blue reddish thin lines is transversal one are circles orthogonal to the real line. They are really straight lines in Lobachevsky geometry. And what are transformation if we are using not complex number by double number, dual numbers? When the calculation shows what in this case, we will have a picture which somehow a bit similar, but rather different in the sense what orbit now are parabolas, not circles. So if we do the same matrix, the same transformation cosine, sine, minus sine, cosine, so we will obtain parabolas for dual numbers, and for double numbers, orbit will be some hyperbolas. Again, you may watch out what are transversal line, which are images of the imaginary axis. So it's in all cases, it's orthogonal to the real axis. In parabolic case, it's straight lines orthogonal to the real axis. And in the hyperbolic case, it is hyperbolas orthogonal to hyperbolic axis. And that gray arrows, which represent infinitesimal generators of this transformation, they have uniform formula, so it's given here, which can be again written with the usage of that parameter sigma, which is square of the imaginary unit in each corresponding case. So it's uniformly represented in this way. And equation of orbits also can be uniformly represented. So and in the caption to the figure is given equation for all orbits. Again, in all three cases, it's uniformly presented by means of that parameter sigma. So that is give you an idea why we are classifying that three cases in terms of elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic. And we will continue more discussion on the next lecture. Okay, thank you very much for coming. Hope to see you next week.